Join classic literary heroes Tom Sawyer, Huck Finn, and Becky Thatcher as they accompany their creator on a suicide mission into outer space. There they will learn valuable lessons about Adam and Eve, frog racing, and the terrifying existential dread that has and will plague the insignificant human race for all of its meaningless existence. We watched The Adventures of Mark Twain. Today on...
The f*** is this?
I would start off the episode by saying a couple of Mark Twain quotes that I found online that I think are somewhat relevant to our podcasting idea here. So I tried to find some Mark Twain quotes that I could apply to the concept of podcasting, and I found three really good ones.
Because they always say he was, like, ahead of his time. I didn't think he really anticipated podcasts.
He knew all about them.
Yeah, he was able to look into the future, and he found some stuff. He found some quotes. He said some quotes that I think are still relevant today. So I'll say this one here. The first one here, he said, "A person who won't listen to podcasts has no advantage over one who can't hear."
That is now, a famous... Mark Twain quote.
I remember that.
He wrote it when he was still going under Samuel Clemens. It was his, that's why it's not, people don't associate it, but, classic.
I have to imagine we all just did like a real quick crash course on a bunch of YouTube videos on the life of Mark Twain in like the last 24 hours.
Well, kind of, but also because I was telling you guys, like, I love this movie, right? Like, I've been watching this since I was a little kid. This was like a household childhood movie of mine. I didn't find out till I was like a teenager that it was apparently banned in a lot of places.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. We're going to get into that in a second. But as a lifelong Mark Twain aficionado, you must have heard this next quote all the time. When your podcast gets out of order, you have a choice of two things to do. You can throw it in the fire or take it to the podcast tinker. The former is the quickest.
Tinker?
Yeah.
Like an editor?
I've been meaning to talk to you about that, Jameson. I think it would be a good idea for us to get a podcast tinker on the books. So have you asked around? Do you know anybody in the tinker community?
Not anyone that would work for free. Which is, you know, no, I can't imagine a tinker would want to make... I would not be comfortable if, like, a tinker is making more money editing a podcast than you and I are earning doing this podcast.
My dad got into a lot of trouble because he piled up some tinker bills when I was a child. And it really set my family back quite a bit. So I have bad history in the tinker community. But it's this last quote that I really feel shows that, you know, Mark Twain must have had one eye into the future. He must have had, like, some sort of wild... fantastical technology, because this real quote kind of stopped me in my tracks, Jameson, kind of set a shiver up my spine. It was Mark Twain who said, "It's not the size of the deputy dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the deputy dog, and how frosty it stays."
See, I always thought that was Hawthorne. It was Twain, eh?
Well, this is a solid intro, I must say.
It's a solid intro, and while we mull that over, allow me to say welcome back, however you wish to self-identify, to the third year of The Fuck Is This, where we dive through DVD bins, sort through streaming apps to find the weird, the bizarre, and the unloved. I'm your host, Kaz Lesgard. Joining me, as he always does, is my equal in hosting the podcast, this podcast, Jameson Rafter.
Yeah, top of the morning, everybody. You're equal. Why? Because you can't settle and call me like a co-host or like a...
We are the same. We are the same.
I mean, I'm a little taller than you, but yeah.
in importance, in attractiveness, in money, we're going to start splitting our finances so we have the same equal amount of money.
I didn't agree to this. Kes, do you need a hand? Do you need some money? Like, I could spot you.
I'm going to get you to look over that contract you signed. I got tinkers after me, man. I got podcast tinkers.
Legal tinkers?
Beating down the door.
Otherwise known as lawyers.
So the reason we're getting all literary for that part, we're getting literal as well. You know, we're not talking in metaphor here. But the reason we're talking literary quotes here at the beginning of this is because today on the show, we're watching a movie. Normally on the show, we try to watch movies that no one has really heard of, but the chances are that you, dear listener, at some point at least had some sort of passing familiarity with the movie that we are watching today, perhaps in childhood, perhaps it gave you nightmares. It might have been flipping through YTV as a kid and came across any frame of this movie. I'm not speaking from personal experience here. Today we're watching 1985's The Adventures of Mark Twain, directed by legendary animator Will Vinton. And to join us on this fantastical journey through space and time is our guest. He's an actor and a YouTuber. You can find him on the internet under the name The Surly Bartender, Garrett Quirk. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me. Thank you very much. This is going to be great.
Yeah, thanks for joining us. Because if I just may interrupt for a second, is this movie very well known? Because it completely was not on my radar, and I just learned about this a couple of weeks ago, and I thought, like, oh, this must be an undiscovered gem. Was this popular? Was this well known?
I'm gonna let Garrett field that one. Is this movie popular?
I'm gonna say, I mean, maybe now, maybe because the internet exists, I think it really gave it like a reinsurgence in terms of like, I don't know. I hope we're allowed to swear on your show. I have a habit of dipping.
It's called
into
the fuck is talk. This?
Yes, we have the worst swear word literally in the title.
Right.
The best swear.
Yeah,
word.
I was going to say the best one. It's not the worst one.
All
but
we
no,
have
I
to
don't
make sure
so.
Is we can't swear in like the first minute.
Right.
Otherwise, YouTube like kind of like dings us on like the search results. But I think we kind of like dinged ourselves from the beginning by calling the show the fuck is
by calling it that. Yeah, we probably shot ourselves in the foot. But it's too late because it's year three, baby.
Big YouTube can't stop us.
Anyway, no, I don't think it was that popular because I remember trying to talk to people about this movie for years growing up, and no one knew what the fuck I was talking about. Like, no one knew.
I'm really excited for this. You know, Garrett, I asked you to be a guest on the show because I wanted to have you on for a while. I'm a big fan of you in general, and also your Surly Bartender videos. I think those are hilarious, and we'll talk a little bit more about those later.
Thanks.
But this was fantastic coincidence because I didn't know that you were a huge fan of this movie. I just kind of picked you out of the blue. We had already planned to do this before I asked you, so it was kind of an amazing happenstance that it worked out that way.
I had no idea. Yeah. Like, it was so funny. You're like, oh yeah, let's do this podcast. I was like, oh yeah, man, I love movies. I'd love to see what kind of random picture you're going to show me. And then he said that. I was like, I thought it was a joke. You know?
No, not
like,
at all.
I was like, oh, you know, you talked to one of my friends, but
no, it was just a happy coincidence, which are my favorite type of coincidence.
I imagine that like a couple of years ago, you guys were just at a party, whatever, and you just were casually mentioning it, and
wow, this guy really deep dived my
Kaz filed it away, and wow, he remembered from all the way back then. Wow, what a pal!
Wouldn't shut up about Mark Twain.
He just kept going on and on. Right? Like, goddamn, Kaz, you pay attention. I'm going to have to remember your birthday some year, you know?
It's Halloween. It's easy to remember.
Oh, yeah, it is Halloween.
Oh, you forgot.
No, I knew that because a few Halloweens. Anyway, we're getting off topic. But yeah, a few Halloweens ago, we were at that party a few Halloweens ago talking about Mark Twain. No, it's one of those movies I've seen so many times. I know, like, every line to the picture. And it's crazy. Like, the movie's just, like, I'm not going to give too much. You know what? I don't even know if I want to say too much about it.
Yeah, but I'm really excited about this episode because I'm sort of in the third category. Garrett, you've seen this movie a lot. Jameson, you've never seen this before. I saw this years ago playing on TV. I barely remember anything about it. And to what you were saying, Garrett, I think it has a slight uptick in online, not even popularity, just visibility. It tends to pop up on a lot of lists of, you know, like 10 movies from your childhood that are totally fucked up, you know, and it's like certainly like, you know, because of sites like cracked.com,
right.
I think this movie maybe has a little bit of a resurgence now. I really don't remember a ton about it. The main thing I remember is the scene.
The mysterious stranger.
Yes, the mysterious stranger scene, which we won't spoil it for you. I wouldn't dream of spoiling.
Isn't that when, like, you masturbate with your non-dominant hand?
That's just the stranger.
Oh,
that's
okay.
Just the stranger, yeah. The mysterious is when you do it with your regular hand, but you numb it first. You numb it.
I see.
Yet another thing we can attribute to Mark Twain. he was the very first to figure that out.
Those boyhood days sailing down the Mississippi.
The entire premise of the movie is fucked up, though. Like, looking back at the movie, like, I mean, yes, that scene is, it's the scene for sure, and that's the one that puts its imprint in your mind, but there's so, the entire movie, it's very
Christian.
You can't see it, I'm leaning into my microphone.
It's very, very Christian.
It's beautiful. It's beautiful. It's some of the best claymation you'll ever see in your life. It took them 4 years to make it in a fucking basement of some house.
Yeah, a team of 17 people made this movie in a barbershop basement.
Yeah.
And it was the first feature-length claymation movie ever made.
Yeah, that's right.
And then there was, like, I don't know how many years long gap before Nightmare Before Christmas. But no, this is, like, sandwiched between the eras of when Rankin and Bass did their claymation, had their empire going. And then there was kind of a lull period before Twas the Nightmare Before Christmas. And then this, kind of, like, right smack dab in the middle. Is that fair to say?
I think an important distinction to make, Jameson, is the difference between claymation and stop motion animation.
Oh, okay.
Which is what Rankin Bass did. Rankin Bass worked primarily with models, but this is 100% clay.
Oh, like Wallace and Gromit stuff.
And it gives it a very distinct style, and this is the perfect segue to talk about the director himself, Will Vinton.
Man, such a beautiful movie. Like, this guy, he did the California Raisins. Remember those cats? Are you guys old enough to remember the California Raisins?
Oh, no,
am I dating
remember.
Myself?
We, yes.
What? Raisins?
Everybody loves the, well, I don't know if everybody loved the California Raisins.
Do you guys remember the PJs? That weird show, the PJs?
He was the producer with.
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay.
There's a very distinct artistic style to Will Vinton's work that doesn't look like anything else. Yeah, he was one, he certainly wasn't the first person to ever do claymation, but he was one of the pioneers of it. He was certainly the first person, I think, to make claymation utterly terrifying. Let's just get this out of the way. Obviously, you have seen this movie a lot more than I have. You've just described it as a beautiful motion
it's
picture.
It's beautiful, like every frame, it's gorgeous. The animation is incredible to think that someone did that with their hands.
I mean, like, yes, I'm not going to argue with you that it isn't an incredible achievement, but I spent a lot of time yesterday before the show watching a lot of Will Vinton's short films, which are pretty much all available on YouTube. I watched his very first movie, a 1975 short animated film called Closed Mondays, which won the Academy Award for short animated film. It's a 7-minute short film about a drunk man who stumbles into an art gallery after hours, and all of the art is alive and it does various things. And it was one of the most unpleasantly disturbing things I've watched in recent memory. It put me in a weird mood, Garrett.
Why?
There is something about the way Will Vinton animates his claymation creatures. He really truly breathes life into these animated figures, but in such a way that when they're walking around and they're looking at stuff, you get the impression that these are sentient beings that have just recently been given life, and the concept of life is like driving them into existential terror.
Well,
like,
funny you say that, because
all of his claymation creatures look horrified that they've been given life, but for some reason there's some sort of unseen puppet master that's making them do things. It truly is like very nightmarish.
Well, you know, like, there's two characters in this movie we're gonna watch that the story of Adam and Eve is a predominant storyline in this movie we're about to watch.
It is?
Yeah.
Interesting. I didn't know that this movie was so religious.
Oh, yeah. It's crazy. I mean, I don't want to tell you all the themes of the picture, but when you say two sentient beings who've just woken, or sentient beings who've just woken up and don't realize, I'm like, haha, that's kind of funny, because that literally happens in this movie we're going to see.
This is interesting. So, I don't know a thing about this movie. I think I just stumbled upon it as I was, like, coming across, like, one of those, like, top 10 creepiest real videos that you were talking about, Kaz. I didn't look into this whatsoever, but I get an impression that's similar to Bubba Hotep or Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter. You know, like, you're taking a real-life American figure who's been sort of deified, and you're putting them in like this supernatural, I want to say even horror setting.
No.
Okay.
The movie really, I mean, like, the by and short of the picture is about a man wanting to die and taking his works of fiction to do that with himself. It's fucked. Like, it's a really fucking crazy movie.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's less scary on the vibe of there's an actual monster, you know, there's vampires and mummies coming to get me, and it's more terrifying on an existential, what is the purpose of my being?
That kind of way. Yeah.
Oh, and it got a G rating!
They showed this to kids? Well, okay, that's not fair. I think, you know, I think kids can handle a bunch of scary shit, you know, when they're kids.
I grew up religious anyway. When you watching something like this just sort of substantiates Bible stories.
Yeah, I mean, I'm always one of the, like, I do, like, some amateur animation stuff on my own. And I'm always the first one to say that, like, kids can, like, they can handle a little bit of the horror stuff. I kind of like where cartoons are not all saccharinely sweet, wholesome stuff. You can have a bit of an edge to it. So I guess I'm not totally against, like, the premise of this. I just think, why center it around Mark Twain?
Yeah, I mean, the movie could have been about a lot. I mean, like I said, I'm not gonna. I don't want to talk too much about. I want to talk more about it when we're done because I don't want to like.
Yeah, we'll get into it. We'll get into it after you've watched it. A few more footnotes about Will Vinton himself. He started his own production company, Will Vinton Studios, which went on to produce other claymation based projects, including, yes, as you said, Eddie Murphy's TV show, The PJs, which I thought was a little ahead of its time. Frankly, I remember watching that when I was younger. I thought that was really good. That must have been an expensive as hell show to make.
Oh,
like
my
a
God.
Prime time claymation sitcom. Like
all the
it's
time.
Amazing that
yeah.
it got as many seasons as it did.
Yeah, 20-minute long episode. Knowing how long it takes them to just make one episode of The Simpsons back in the day, I can only imagine how long it took them to do a single episode of the PJs. I don't know how fucking Robot Chicken does it.
Well, Robot Chicken is working with less of a budget than these people were.
Way
so,
less.
And it shows.
It does
frankly.
Show. And the show's only like 10 minutes long or whatever, right?
It's you
like
know, I just said long. I was somewhat of an animator. You think I would know a little bit more about animation? But then again, if you've seen my shit, you know that I cut a lot of corners.
Well, but you do computer animation. You've never worked with models, I'm taking it. You've never put, like, an action figure in one post, like, taken a photo and then moved it incrementally and then done that for, like, 14 months. So, you know, it's
you
it's
never do it for 14 months. You guys have done. But you must have done stop
I've
motion
I've done a couple of,
kid.
Like, stop motion stuff with my toys when I was a kid, but...
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
You usually get, like, 30 seconds of footage if you're lucky, and that's when you're like, okay, I never want to do this again.
Yeah, well, this was boring as hell to make, and it didn't turn out great.
And,
fuck it.
It looks awful. Yeah.
Even as a kid, I didn't have the patience for that. I didn't. I mean, why create a movie when I can take my action figures and just make the movie in my head?
It's true.
That's where I want to see it.
That's
in
the
my
theater
brain.
In you. That's a theater-based actor in you, man. You know,
that's
do it
right.
live shows. Live fucking shows.
Don't remind me of live fucking shows right now. It's not like I'm going to be able to scratch that itch. So Will Vinton Studios is also responsible for a couple of other pop culture landmarks. He helped animate various segments for other movies. He was responsible for the gnome creatures in Return to Oz, talking about nightmarish movies.
Yeah, that's right. He did.
But as you mentioned earlier, Garrett, he's perhaps best known. His legacy is perhaps best known for his work in advertisement. He created three icons of, iconography, nostalgic-based, advertisement, commercial-based characters. Of course, the big one is the California Raisins, which a lot of people forget were created to literally sell raisins, but it inexplicably became so popular it got their own spin-off TV specials. I think they almost had a video game and then got canceled, but Nintendo Power still reviewed it. That's the one thing I remember about the California Raisins. Less successful, of course, than the California Raisins is our old buddy, the Noid.
It was the Noid! I knew it! I knew as soon as he said it, I was like, oh shit, the Noid!
I was gonna say, like,
he did get a video game!
He did get a video
he
game!
He got a video game!
Yo, Noid!
That was a reskin of a different Japanese video game that they just turned into the Noid and they just added pizza to it.
Fuck, that game was an eyesore, but it had such a great opening track. You just play it just for that.
That game stuck in my memory. I have a vivid memory of going to visit my mom's friend in Ottawa. I don't even remember the name of these people. All I remember is that their son had Yo Noid for the NES, and I remember playing it. I remember thinking it was bullshit that I couldn't get past the first level because that game's hard.
Oh my god, all those games. I've got games I still haven't beat the second level too.
In addition to Raisins and Domino's Pizza, he also, or I guess maybe his production studio, also contributed to the creation of probably his most successful mascot, the M&M's characters.
Oh, those are hits?
Yeah, and I did not know that until I looked that up on Wikipedia, but apparently Will Vinton had a hand in creating the M&M mascots, and I went on YouTube and I looked around and saw, like, were they originally in claymation? But no, they've always been CG creations, or I guess before that they were hand-drawn, but that was before they had the personalities that we attribute to them now with the voiceover actors. But yeah, no, apparently Will Vinton Studios is still, I don't know if they've sold the rights to the characters or whatever or whatnot, but like, yeah, no, apparently he also helped creating those iconic, lovable characters.
I guess you can kind of see it in their arms and legs, the noodle arms and noodle legs, you know what I mean, that I call it? I don't know what else to call it. A lot of his characters have that noodle
With
appendage.
The white gloves and everything and sort of the blocky looking shoes, yeah.
Big feet. Giant feet, so the thing will stay standing up the whole time, right?
Do you guys know who voices the two M&Ms? The main ones, the red and the yellow one?
Well, they've been been voiced by various actors over the years, but I believe what you're alluding to is Billy West and J.K. Simmons.
I know, right?
Yes. Now, I'm not 100% J.K. Simmons is still voicing the yellow M&M. I kind of feel like in a post-Whiplash world, he doesn't necessarily need that M&M money anymore. I might be wrong. Who knows?
I need that sweet M&M money.
He's probably just like, oh, I'm not doing anything today. Yeah, sure, I'll pop by the recording studio. What
he
the hell?
He just rolls into the recording studio with his Oscar in tow. I love this job. But, you know, they haven't always been voiced by those guys. If you go earlier back, the original voices of Red and Yellow were originally John Lovitz and John Goodman.
Oh.
So it's always kind of been... And actually, if you listen to what Billy West is doing, he's kind of doing a John Lovitz voice. So yeah, he's very much...
They need that one deep timber and that one nasally whiny guy, yeah.
Totally. Yeah. And James Whitmore is in this picture. He's the voice of Mark Twain. Brooks he's was here, the... man! Brooks was here!
That's who that is? Oh, shit! Oh, yeah. Okay. Huh.
I didn't know that for years. And I looked this guy up and I was like, ah, oh, James Whitmore, of course.
That's the saddest fucking scene in Shawshank Redemption. Oh.
It's not a good one. It's a hard scene to get through, that's all. Everybody loves that movie. Everybody loves that movie.
Yeah.
There's not a person in the world doesn't like it.
Yeah.
See, but you don't hate it. Right?
I don't hate it.
You don't
I
love
don't hate it.
But
I don't
like the movie.
I
it's a movie you watch in the afternoon. It's on the, you know, it's always on television for 4 hours.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, and I would argue that is precisely why Shawshank Redemption has sort of gained the traction that it has, because it wasn't a well-received movie when it came out, even though it got a bunch of Oscar nominations, it wasn't, like, popular. But because it just aired on Sundays on TNT for, like, 2 decades or something like that, it has just exploded. Part of the reason why Shawshank has sort of gained the traction that it has is entirely because of IMDb. Held that spot at the top of the 250 greatest movies of all time list for so long, it just kind of entered. Look, Shawshank Redemption is a good movie. It's good. I don't hate it. I just don't think it's amazing, which makes me an outlier, so
it's
controversial.
No, it's fair. Anyway, I guess...
Calm down, Cash. Sit down.
No, that's fine. We can talk. I mean, we were going to talk about Shawshank anyway because James Whitmore... In this introduction thing, we often talk about the actors in this movie. James Whitmore is really the only actor who did other things outside of this. Even though I don't think I could name another James Whitmore movie other than Shawshank off the top of my head. Do you...
That's
I can't. I know he was in a lot of things, but I think...
Yeah, he's a double Oscar nominee, but I had never heard of either of the movies he was nominated for because they were like from like the 40s. But yeah, there we go. Brooks was here.
All right, well, do we want to talk about Mark Twain then? Like, do any of our listeners not know who Mark Twain is?
That guy in books?
Yeah, he was the first guy that sat on his hand and then masturbated.
That's right.
Everybody knows. We've been down this road. Let's not repeat ourselves, guys.
Yeah, okay, well...
Yes, let's not repeat ourselves. And hey, in the interest of not repeating ourselves, let's take a short break and go watch The Adventures of Mark Twain. And when we come back, Jameson will be a different person. We'll all be different people, because that's how time works.
I'll just be frank here, like, I never read any Mark Twain as a kid. I know some of the broad strokes about his life.
He's fantastic. You should read him.
Or the father of, like, the great American novel. He's a humorist, lecturer, you know, famously wrote Huckleberry Finn, Tom Sawyer.
Loves that N-word. Can't get enough of it.
Mm. He wrote Tom Sawyer, but I gotta say, Rush perfected it, so,
Alright, well, on that note, alright, join us if you join us in a few minutes. You think I'd get better at this over time, but anyway,
join us down a laser stroll down the Mississippi River. Hi everyone. Today's charity spot is going to involve a brief history lesson. When Metro Sportswear was founded in 1957, which was later renamed to Canada Goose of luxury jacket fame, the Winnipeg, Manitoba company was regarded as a strong union company, which recognized and supported its workers' union right up until the company was sold majority ownership to U.S.-based equity firm Bain Capital in 2013. Since then, the mostly immigrant workforce has had to endure not only deunionization, racial discrimination, and anti-unionization efforts, but also in the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic, broken bathrooms, lack of sanitizer, social distancing protocol violations, and all while workers are refocused production efforts on making essential PPE for hospitals. These absolutely account for unsafe working conditions in these times, and that's without even getting into the reports of emergency exits being padlocked. These unspeakable sweatshop-like conditions should have no place on Canadian soil, or anywhere for that matter. This is why, for our charity shout-out, I highly encourage you to visit workersunited.ca, an organization representing over 10,000 workers across Canada, and 100,000 more across the United States over a wide range of industries and communities, and signed their petition supporting the immigrant women factory workers of Bain's Canada Goose, fighting for a union, fair pay, and safe working conditions. The direct link can be found at workersunited.ca/Bain_Canada_Goose_petition. Look, government regulation and red tape can be a pain, but if you don't tell businesses they are specifically required to do things, people are going to end up exploited or dead or both. Winston Churchill once said, "Where you have a powerful organization on both sides, there you have a healthy bargaining. But where you have what we call sweated trades, you have no organization, no parity of bargaining, the good employer is undercut by the bad, and the bad employer is undercut by the worst. Where those conditions prevail, you have not a condition of progress, but a condition of progressive degeneration." So again, please visit workersunited.ca/Bain_Canada_Goose_petition and show your support.
Okay, so for the start of this, I thought it might be funny if we all talked over each other like the characters in the movie.
Well,
so,
Kessler, that's got to be the most hog-brained idea you've ever had.
No, hold on. No,
wait a second. I'll put my money on Malice, bro.
You're going to do this podcast?
Me too. Oh, dang, oh, blast it. I lost every dang dollar in that whole bank.
Stop this. Stop. This was a terrible idea. I just realized. This isn't going to translate to a podcast at all.
No, it's very appropriate that we open with each other talking over each other because that happens quite a bit in this movie.
They got no time. They got no time to waste.
We got to catch Halley's Comet.
This was the most Altman-esque animated movie I've seen in a long time, yes. But, anyway, but we're back. We're back from the adventures of Mark Twain and also mostly Adam and Eve. But that's fine. We learned a lot.
Did we learn a lot? I feel like I know less about Mark Twain now than when I started the show.
You know clips of his stuff. It's like Cliff's Notes, or what do we have up here? Cole's Notes?
Mm.
Cole's Notes.
Yeah.
Of Mark Twain's work. If you wanted, like, roulette Mark Twain, brah! Mm. And you get, like, little snippets, like, after the gun is fired. So, like, bits of the bullet. And then you put that in a blender, and then you write a script with it.
I could definitely see a kid from our era having to do some sort of oral report on Mark Twain at school, and he didn't do the work, but I'm assuming it's a boy, because that's how we work. But, you know, he didn't do the work, he didn't put the effort into it. But he watched this, yeah, he just, like, cribbed notes, he got the gist of it. And even with just the gist of it going into the, he'd probably get, like, a C+, is all like,
there were so many quotes! He could quote just this movie for days, and he's like, oh, he obviously read it because there are so many actual Mark Twain quotes in this movie. When the person wrote this report, they would have had to go to the library and looked everything up on those cards, so it's not like the teacher could, like, Google the information to make sure he wasn't fucking.
Not even a fucking student. I would imagine that that's what the screenwriter did. They were too timid to write dialogue for Mark Twain, so they just took every single one of his notable witticisms and quotes, and then they just sort of weaved other people's dialogue so that he could set it up with a witticism.
It's true. It's like every line is a punchline for Mark Twain's benefit in this picture, which, you know, is, I don't know, I think it does the movie good, to be honest.
Jameson, welcome to every single one-man show about Mark Twain that has ever existed in history. Because that's all they are. Just dressing up in a white suit, coming out with a cigar in their hand, and just quotes, because that guy was a quoting machine, if this movie is anything to believe.
I don't think I've ever seen a one-man show about Mark Twain where, like, he flies in on a sweet fucking steampunk riverboat blimp.
It's his body of work. It's that cool. His body of work is so cool.
His literal metaphorical body of work is a floating riverboat.
Flying riverboat.
Did they ever explain where that came from?
No, that's the best part about the movie, is it doesn't explain, like, I don't know, fucking 75%. It's like, nah, you should know.
Because, like, one of the things I know about Mark Twain that, like, always comes up whenever you do any research on him was that he had a friendship with Nikola Tesla. So did he build him that thing? That'd be an easy explanation for how we got
it. But he never got that sweet Elon Musk money.
Yeah. Well, I think that's the thing. Like, Nikola Tesla
I don't think he really got the credit he was due until, like, much, much later on in, probably even into the 90s or even the early
2000s. Oh, we saw the drunk history. We know about the capitalistic ways of
Thomas Edison,
he died, like, broken, depressed, right?
In love with a pigeon.
Mark Twain.
Anyway, yes, back to Mark Twain, yes. If I had to put money on it, my take is that it's more of a metaphorical blimp than like an actual tangible blimp, Jameson. That's how this is a journey of the mind.
It's a spaceship of the imagination is what it is.
I can sum this movie up pretty easily because we see, we get the information dump at the beginning, with the text.
The Star Wars opening, like, the text crawl?
Yes.
It's true. Whole movie is in the text crawl. We don't need to see the rest of it.
We live in a post-Rise of Skywalker world. It's not the stupidest Star Wars crawl that's ever existed. Let's just say that, yeah. The dead speak! Also a Mark Twain quote. But, this movie's fairly easy to sum up. I kind of got it in that first opening crawl because it mentioned sort of the central conceit of this movie. Real history, Mark Twain was born on the day, or really close to the time, that Halley's Comet came around, and then he died when it came back around again. It's like a footnote in his history. But what this opening text tells us is that the date of his death was April 21st, 1910. So my theory is that this entire movie is just the after effects of one hell of a good 420 for Mark Twain. Smoking that reefer. Smoking that 1880s reefer.
Dude, hemp was a big thing back then. Hemp was industrialized the way it should be. Like, I don't give a shit about marijuana. I mean, I like it. Hemp has so much more uses, and he would have probably had, like, fields of it just hanging out. You know? Yeah, I got, like, 20 plants for shits and giggles. What are you kidding me?
Roll some up into his cigars and everything? Yeah, yeah.
Oh, brilliant. You're right. My God.
I mean, that really just explains the entire movie. It's all like, whoa, man, that frog is turning into liquid, man.
No,
whoa,
this is an acid trip at best. This is not
it
fucking...
just
I wish
ate
this was
an entire
movie.
Rucksack, man, including like a pan with bacon and eggs right in it. I'm high as balls,
dude.
Dude,
what if there was a bunch of heavens for different alien races and you went to the wrong one?
Well, that's one of the best parts of the movie, because that, like, has nothing to do with the rest of this. It comes in out of fucking nowhere. I don't know the story of Captain Stormfield. I never read it.
Well, I think I got the gist of it.
Yeah, right? I don't think we need to.
Yeah.
But that's the fucking best part. But yeah, you go to the heaven you want to go to. I don't like this heaven. Well, you're not going to like the heaven you think you like either.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I thought that was a good commentary that, like, man doesn't know what the afterlife is going to look like, so it's not going to look like any of, like, the ones that humanity have envisioned for itself. It's going to be fucked up and crazy looking.
Yeah.
That said, that alien heaven looked fucking rad as hell.
Dude, look, go. Man's got to be in his own heaven to be happy. Go to someone else's heaven. That sounds like more fun.
Just tell me what religion I have to follow to get the Gleep Glorp.
Oh, it's Catholic.
Like,
it's
that's
Catholic.
All I want. I'll convert. If you need, I don't know, like, if you need, it's pretty late for, like, some sort of, like, ceremony, but, like,
it's
I don't
never
know,
too
I'll,
late,
like, I'll marry into it,
you
I don't know,
on your
I just want to know. I want two other heads that talk to me in unison, man. Man, I had forgotten so much about this movie. Basically, it was just the Mysterious Stranger thing that was, like, rolling around in my head, because we're going to talk about that scene.
Let's talk about the other stuff before we get into that, because that's, like, a significant portion of our conversation. It's going to be dedicated to that. Holy shit.
Well, it's a fairly straightforward plot to recap, because for the most part, it's almost a portmanteau type movie, because there's like a central story, there's like a wraparound story, but then occasionally it will go and it will tell Mark Twain stories, it will tell stories from his oeuvre and whatnot. If I had to level one criticism before we get into talking
oeuvre.
About the plot,
hang on, we gotta stop at oeuvre.
Anyways.
we just glossed over it, and like when I looked and I was like, we're not gonna make fun of this. It's oeuvre.
Yeah, might pull that word out of. I think I've.
Where'd you get that word? Where'd you find it? Oeuvre. They come français le Louvre.
Hey, you know what, Garrett? It is an excellent word, and it bears repeating.
Oh,
hey,
fuck. Nice job!
Wow. I watched the movie. Good.
Fuck you, Mark Twain.
Fuck, that was great. Good job, man.
Is I didn't realize oeuvre was an impressive word. It's, you know, it a body of work. I don't know.
His body of work. He's floating body of work. Man, you're just tying it all in. Jesus. Look at this guy.
Oeuvre la. A car hold. Yeah.
Yeah. Totally what I had right there. I'm sorry about that.
All right, Jameson. Start us off.
Okay,
James and Fresh Eyes, come in with us.
Yeah, Jesus Christ. Oh, like, I wish I didn't have Fresh Eyes for that walk. I want to gouge my eyes out at some of those fucking scenes. Like, holy shit. Like,
yeah, they'll
you guys
haunt you
watch
forever.
This as kids? I was saying that, like, oh, like, yeah, kids can handle a lot of, you know, spooky stuff. I didn't think they could handle, like, existential shit at, like, age fucking 7 or 8. Holy.
I mean, look, don't even bring kids into it. There are images from this movie that, as I was watching it less than an hour ago, just chilled me. Just, like, chilled me to my soul. Like, put me in, like, a weird headspace where I'm just like, I don't like looking at this. It's really unnerving, and
I don't like looking at it. I don't like listening to some of the things that they're saying. Like, it's really pessimistic and cynical and
guys, it's not 80s cinema unless it makes you uncomfortable, especially cartoons. Because you guys, I don't remember, like Land Before Time and shit, and fucking All Dogs Go to Heaven. Do you guys remember All Dogs? With Dom DeLuise, you see Burt Reynolds get killed like twice in that movie, at least. And shot with a ray gun.
Mm-hmm. Do you suppose there's a deleted scene where Burt Reynolds' dog goes up to heaven and it's a bunch of alien dogs with three heads? And it's like a whole, like, thing.
And he's like, I don't want to leave. I'm not going to reset this clock. I love it here. Fuck you. This movie can go fuck itself. So, I'm hanging out in fucking dog three-head heaven. Oh my god, three-head heaven.
Cerberus, yeah, he's guarding the gates of heaven.
Cerberus! Oh my god, Jameson, that's incredible, because Cerberus was the guard of the underworld.
That's what I'm going
like
with
the next
you, yeah.
Whoa, we're fucking blowing the lid off of this. Holy shit.
Yeah, it's his good-natured cousin who works upstairs. Anyways, this
Jeff, he's a good shit.
So this
everybody
is
loves
story
Jeff.
Of good shit. Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn just, like, lazing out on a raft.
And Becky Thatcher. Oh, sorry.
And Becky Thatcher, yeah. They long for adventure. They say, like, well, there's an opportunity town. There's a big blimp that's going to go up into the sky and, like, in the middle of this fucking farm field. So they go to check it out. And it's Mark Twain aboard his massive, awesome riverboat blimp that has elevator with a portal door.
Indexivator.
I don't know how the fuck that thing works.
It goes from any of his stories to any of his stories. Stories.
This is a smart movie.
But how do you even, like, get into it, because there's no fucking door. You just kind of waltz right through this
fucking
wall.
Yeah, it's really unfair.
And you're knee-deep into
Now,
Twain
this
territory.
Was my first question of the movie, because I can read into this, and I can kind of, I mean, like, the first question is all like, okay, look, here are the characters from a Mark Twain novel who are now going to see this event that is hosted by Mark Twain. So in this world, who is Mark Twain to them? Because he's not the author of Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn, because that is them. And I can read into the movie as an adult, and I can come to the conclusion, oh, well, this isn't really happening, it's a metaphor, he's going on the journey to, like, the next life, and he's bringing his characters with him, and then, you know, spoilers, jumping to the end and everything, they live on after he is gone, and they will continue to live on after him. But, so, like, obviously the characters in the story don't stand around contemplating this, wait, who is Mark Twain? How do we know who this is? They just automatically know who Mark Twain is, because the story needs to keep going, and we need, you know, we need to move this thing along. But, you know, if we're living in, like, the world of these characters, like, is Mark Twain, because I know he wrote more stories than Huckleberry Finn and Tom Sawyer, but I'm, like, you know, for uneducated snobs like me, that's what he's famous for. So he's just the guy who wrote a Connecticut Yankee in Kid Arthur's Court, maybe, which I guess is popular.
Movie is super meta, though. The character is very meta. I think he understands that he's in the story that's in the movie, because when you consider, like, all the alternate Mark Twains, not just the dark side, which you find out about later on, and he's spooking them out the whole movie, but then also the writer's block version they tie up. Like, he knows he's in a story, so because of all those meta moments throughout the picture.
Yeah, there's a sequence even where they have to jettison some weight, and he says, like, oh, don't throw that out.
That won't be published for years yet. Yeah, totally.
So he just has, like, this interest, like, he knows every, like, placements of, you know, space and time, and he could see into the future, totally aware of, like, his legacy and the legacy of his characters. And yet Becky, Tom, and Huck never once stumble upon their own pieces of fictional work, and like, how does this guy know about our lives?
They do exactly that, because they're in the elevator and they see the different stories that are all,
and they go, you know, to Injun Joe. You're right, you're totally right.
And then they go,
and it wouldn't be Mark Twain if it wasn't a little racist. Like that. Oh, yeah, that's the racist part of the movie.
Thankfully, all we get is the mention of the name. It's kind of hard to avoid because the name of the character is Injun Joe,
who's a half half Native American antagonist in the first Tom and Huck story.
But. Look, we're not going to get on our podcast and make the claim that Mark Twain is problematic. He was a man of his time. All right, let's just assume.
No,
and I think
right.
You're the expert of the three of us here, Garrett.
Hardly,
like,
hardly.
Read much
disclaimer,
of it,
full disclaimer.
Full disclaimer. Like, full disclaimer, hardly. Like, he was, like, sure, obviously, there's stuff that in his books that wouldn't fly today, but for the time, Mark Twain was a fairly progressive person, yes?
I think so. I mean, I saw that episode of Star Trek Next Generation when he's hanging out with Guinan and Data there, and he's trying to make things work. I think he's pretty progressive.
Yeah, that historical document. Yeah, no, we're all familiar. Yeah,
we're all familiar. There's like two people listening goes, I get that.
Hey, look, if Guinan vouches for him, then he's okay with me.
Yeah, I do know that the N-word Jim character was like brought up to address like the racial commentary of the day and offer his criticism for like the treatment and like sort of the aftermath of the Civil War. So yes, I know, like, even for like to modern context, he is rightfully like kind of out of place, but for the time, yeah, he was like a more forward-thinking, progressively minded author.
Oh man,
it's just unfortunate that that character is literally named N-word Jim, and every time he is mentioned in the book, it is N-word Jim.
Yeah, we mean
neighbors. But it isn't.
It's super important that that's the case, because it's a perfect representation of white mentality towards black people during that time. I mean, that whole work. Huck Finn is metaphorical of like, you know, oh, life is only free in a fucking raft by yourself with your friend in the middle of the fucking river, nowhere else in the, you know what I mean? Like, and that's why this movie's so great, because the whole movie's metaphorical. It's like the biggest fanboy, fuck you, I love you, Mark Twain, so much, I want to jizz all over your face movie. Because it, like, takes everything and then just, like, yeah, fuck it. Put it on acid. You got some acid? Throw it on there.
Somewhere Mark Twain is, like, looking down on that those sentiments and got a little tear in his eye thinking, he gets me.
I hope it's a tear and not just, you know, what we were talking about just now.
Jizz and clay don't mix very well. I know that from experience.
I was gonna
moving
say
on immediately.
Personal
no follow-up questions. Moving on immediately. All right, what happens?
It's plasticine you want, you silly. Plasticine. That's the key.
So Tom, Huck, and Becky, they stow away onto the blimp. Mark Twain doesn't seem surprised, doesn't seem to mind at all.
Because he wrote the story.
Yeah, he says, like, oh, I'm gonna go up to Halley's Comet. I intend to go out with it. He's, like, not really keeping this a fucking secret to himself. And just, you know, for the first half of the movie, like, they're just going through, like, his oeuvre, his body of work, starting with, what's that story about the frog?
Fucking Calaver's Counting Frog. The old jumping frog of Calaver's County.
Can I just add a sidebar in here? Because you made me think of something here, Garrett. I know the technical term for this style of animation is claymation. I wonder, was there ever a period where they considered plasticinema instead?
They did. It was an L.A. Valley thing, but it turns out it's easier to hire a person to do those disgusting things than a bunch of people to, you know, animate that with plasticine.
Okay. Anyway, moving back to the frog story. I don't know.
I didn't know where to go with that. Fuck, you gave me a lead and I tried. This is as good as I could do. I'm sorry. Short note.
That's more than most of our guests do, so I appreciate it. Thank you. They normally just let my terrible jokes hang in the air, and then everyone listening is just hyper aware of what a fucking idiot I am, so it's all right.
I don't think anyone in this room farted. That smell was always here.
Garrett, I gotta say, you were right when you said that this is, like, to a degree, a really beautiful looking movie. Like, the artistry that went into the actual clay sculptures, it looks fine. I mean, yes, most of the characters are built like fucking candy apples with, like, and hobbit feet, but, you know, the water effects look nice. A lot of the green screen effects around the flying ship look nice.
Dude, that transition at the top of the film, like, right at the beginning when they go from the ship to the swamp or whatever, just
beautiful. Beautiful. Yeah. Because it was clay. Oh, yeah, we're going to carve this clay out that we just carved into something nice. We're just going to smear it and then put something else on it.
Yeah, and like, some of the, like the transitional effects, I think, are where it kind of falls apart. Like, when Mark Twain has, like, his awesome touchscreen effect and he places the frog on it, and then the frog shrinks down into the monitor so he can be incorporated into the story.
Not a good effect.
Like, I don't know how this fucking ship works. I don't know how anything works.
It confused the hell out of me as a child because I was like, oh, okay, so I guess the frog's the character in the story even though he looks different.
Yeah, Huck Finn's frog, Homer, who, like, he just all incorporated into the story because, you know, we got to talk about this frog that would have won a jumping race if, like, the competitor didn't, you know, fill his belly full of bowling balls and wrenches and shit.
Yeah. Is the moral of that story, don't leave your frog behind if your entire economy is based on frog betting?
I don't know. I don't think it's a moral so much as it's just like, hey, that's his first story, and we're going to mention it because it was his first. Because the moral is, I don't know, don't be a degenerate gambler who tries to fix the odds. Because I trained this frog to fucking be the best fucking frog ever.
Is that fixing the odds? That's not, if he's dealing with, like, if his whole thing is all like, hey, let's bet on frog jumping, I feel like it's well within his rights to train the frog how to jump well.
I completely agree.
The other guy was fixing the odds when he was stuffing them full of frying pans and bowling balls and whatnot. There's a moral here. There's a moral here, and we're going to squeeze it out.
We'll sniff it out. We'll sniff it out.
The moral is, like, the moral there is, like, I would not sit around to watch, like, some old men bet on a frog race. That seemed like a really slow afternoon if that was, like,
there wasn't much to do back then.
And everyone bet on it. Hell, when we just did that opening with the dialogue and the fucking ad-libbing, all I did was quote that scene.
Pretty much, yeah. I loved those characters. I mean, like, I loved how most of the characters were portrayed with some exceptions, but I loved those prospector characters. I love how, like, that was, I mean, it wasn't a day off because, you know, that claymation thing is a nightmare to get done, but I love how they must have been all like, well, at least we don't have to animate any mouths in this scene,
because everyone has mustaches. That's
the size of their fucking head.
That was my fucking cheat when I was animating the police captain character in Kilroy. Just give him a big bushy mustache.
Brilliant.
I love a big fucking cartoon mustache.
Brilliant.
Yeah,
smart. I love that whole story. It's just so silly.
It's so
put
folksy.
My money on Smiley's frog.
Me too. And he calls someone a some bitch in our G-rated movie. He goes, you're dumb some bitch. Sorry, dumb some bitch. You're dumb some bitch. Bitch. It's mumbly, but you hear it. You hear, it's like in, you know, you ever watch the Super Mario Super Show?
Oh, yeah.
Hey, fuck you, Luigi!
Yes, exactly! You know?
Hey, paisanos!
In the first episode! Hey, fuck you, Luigi! And it went out on the air!
Do you know what's been making me laugh? You reminded me of this. What's been making me... It's one of, like, those YouTube holes that you fall down, and it's all like, this is the dumbest joke, but it still continues to be funny. Have you seen... I guess someone took a clip. There was, like... Someone made, like an educational video, and they had the rights to the Mario characters.
Okay.
And it was, like, Mario and Luigi telling kids about a bunch of various subjects and whatnot. But it's just, like, this one isolated audio clip that I guess, like, Mario's talking to the kids...
Here's my brother Luigi now to tell you a whole heap of a spaghetti pile of informazione. Hello, Mario.
Oh, I think I see it. Thanks, Mario.
I don't know, like, they didn't bother to tell that voice actor that he needed to do a Luigi voice, so he just goes, Hello, Mario. I'm Luigi. My name is Luigi, and I'm here to tell you about the constellations. I don't know, that's great. I'll link to that.
I love it.
I haven't, but it's amazing.
So moving on.
No, this is relevant. This is all relevant, okay? Relevant,
we don't go
Jameson.
On tangents here. It's fine.
Sorry, I'm just, like we're done with the frog things. We gotta move on to, like, the next two big ones, which are Adam and Eve. And so later on, the kids go exploring the ship, and they come across Mark Twain's parlor room in the fucking...
Organ pool room.
The organ pool room.
Sad organ and play no billiards room. No one plays pool, but it's there.
That's where I'd be spending most of my time on a fucking ship like that.
Right?
Just tells him about, here's a story I have where I come up with reinterpretation of the story of Adam and Eve. Yeah, this really does take most of the first half of the movie and then a considerable portion of the later half of the movie.
It does take up about half of the running time, just this Adam and Eve.
It's an actual book.
Like, The Diary of Adam and Eve is a Mark Twain written book.
I feel like I've read it, like, honestly.
Well, actually, you kind of have. Because
because
it took me years to find it, and I found it to give as a gift to my sister, because she and I were the only two weirdos in the universe who know this movie.
Not anymore.
That is two more. Aren't you glad you're listening, folks? Four fucking assholes know the fucking plot to a movie you never heard of from the 80s. Which is the most 80s fucking movie in the world. Let's fucking get that out of the way right now. It's the most...
Also, a bunch of assholes talking about a movie you've never heard of, that's our entire podcast, so that's fine. If you're listening to this point, you're here for a reason.
And that's the t-shirt. It reads all of that. It's about fucking 40, 50 words.
It goes all the way down. Around the back. That's right. Yeah.
It's in Star Wars quotas. It gets smaller and smaller as you go up the top.
It'll have to be
we just take a random episode of the podcast and we just transcribe word for word everything we say, and then that's just the t-shirt.
That's the t-shirt. Just words. There's no actual shirt. It's just words sewn together.
No one else is doing that.
No, patent pending. Patent pending. The book has like two more chapters maybe at best. It's crazy how much of that they shove into this movie.
As someone who hasn't read a Mark Twain book, I feel like this is a really good barometer for getting why he was considered the forefather of satire and humor, because obviously lots of time has passed since he wrote this story, but you can sort of imagine the sensibilities that people would have had when he wrote this story, and it seems very quaint to us, this sort of retelling of, you know, the book of Genesis from the perspective of Adam and Eve, and just kind of these wry, let's call them coffee table book observations about, like, oh, she calls it a fish, and, you know, and like stuff like that. But I imagine at the time, this was really revolutionary. I can't imagine anyone else was doing this, was taking stories from the Bible and then giving them a first-person perspective. I feel like that was sort of Mark Twain's wheelhouse.
Yeah, like through the modern eyes, and like why Eve takes to naming everything, and she's like actually very good at, you know, coming up with the names and stuff, just because, you know, grass is called grass because it looks like grass. Adam is like, he's kind of impatient with Eve when they first meet each other, and they're afraid of each other. And she says, oh, day one, I chased him up a tree. You know, day two, he wouldn't go up the tree, so I had to throw shit at him so he'd go up the tree again. You know, like,
there's a couple of things with this animation style, with this claymation style, where it's kind of like, it's beautiful, but like, it's kind of awkward sometimes. Like when Adam is hiding in the tree and then he falls out, but they kind of animate him falling down and up at the same time, and he can't quite, it's like he's doing cartwheels in the tree. He can't quite figure it out. It's very charming.
I think it's kind of like the thing, well, because you were talking about earlier about, before we watched the movie, about like how claymation has this realistic whatever that always bothers you because it like gives you this nightmarish thing. It's because it's like this hyper realism with cartoony rules.
Yeah.
And between the two, your brain's like trying to process both. It's like, fuck, I don't know what to fucking, because you understand it's a real thing in real time. I mean, not real time, excuse me, you know what I mean?
Yeah, made but like time. Most of the scenes are like shot like very like the camera is like it's stable on the ground, like it is kind of locked in to that one frame, and you can tell that everything is tangible and like in a 3D space, but it's that uncanny valley where you can tell that no, these are not real people, these are cartoon images, but they don't move like how cartoons are meant to move. We know that these are fake, but yes, there is like an element of, there's an element of realism there. Realism.
Their facial expressions? Like how much time would that have taken just to make someone like raise their eyebrows the way they do? Because their whole face moves all the time. It's beautiful.
It's amazing. Like you say, there is the uncanny valley element to it as well, but it is kind of amazing how the claymation faces from this movie from 1985, you compare that to something like, I don't know, say like the Polar Express. Like, these look more realistically human than those abominations do, you know? And it's kind of amazing how with the advent of more technology and, you know, actors with dots all over their faces capturing all of their expression, this looks more like a person than that does. It's kind of wild.
I think it's because like there are those noticeable imperfections on it and exaggerations that you're like, okay, like, well, my brain is understanding that like this is not a real person, but I recognize the flourishes that you could see in like a regular human face.
Yes.
Totally. Let's talk about the Garden of Eden. I
you mean
love
the fucking
this.
Dr. Seuss world?
I loved how this was realized. There are so many little details, and this really begs another viewing of this movie so I can, like, catch all of the stuff. I love little details. Like, did you notice how, like, there were, like, grapefruit trees, but the tree was literally just a huge grapefruit at the end of, like, a trunk?
Yeah.
And all the trees kind of resembled that, except for the apple tree, and there's kind of like a moment where God's like, oh, that won't do, and it's kind of like laying the seeds to the fact, like, oh, I meant trees to look like this, but then the apple tree was a mistake. You know what? I'll just put a big no-no sign on the front of it. I also love God. I love how God... Like this isn't like a benevolent, all-seeing God. He's kind of a dork. I kind of love that. He's kind of like Adam.
He kind of like fucks up. Adam. It's like your first time going into like a level creator in Mario Maker or Minecraft or something, right? Like he's a, ooh, no. He's experimenting a little bit.
Oops.
And I
love when he's trying to nudge Adam awake, like an actual physical hand comes into the animation.
Huge, giant hand?
That was one of my favorite moments. I love that.
That's great. Well,
I loved how the lion was colored blue at the start. And, like, most of the animals are just, like, these, like, odd combination of color schemes. Like, that's cute. I like that.
But that's until after the garden is gone. And they go back, then they come to, like, the colors we come to know them as.
Yeah, because Eve has introduced death into the world by eating the apple.
That's right. A friend of mine 100 years ago, I showed a friend of mine this picture because I've got it on this VHS tape that my dad recorded off the television back in the day when, you remember like scrambler boxes and you had to like call the number? This is before they even bothered with area codes. Back in the day, kids, we only needed to know 7 instead of 9.
Exactly. And I know what you're talking about. We didn't have one, but my cousins did.
Well, we didn't have one either, but they do these promotional weekends or some shit where they'd be like, hey, check it out for a weekend. So, like, this scroll with their number is constantly playing on the VHS copy we have. And I showed it to my friend, he watched it, and I'm like, what did you think of the picture, Artem? And he's like, it's beautiful because Adam and Eve give up paradise for love. And I'd never considered that before. Even now, just watching with you guys, there were a lot of things I'd never considered because I'd never been very analytical of the movie because I'd grown up with it so much.
Yeah, it was just, you just knew it was like a goofy kids movie. But, you know, exactly. As you mature and kind of look at it from like,
goofy in quotes.
Let's, yes, you know. that thick quotes. That's like 4 or 5 quotes.
Yeah, like, no, when they have absolutely, I picked up on, like, when they come from a place that, where they have absolutely everything available to them, you know, once all that is taken away, all that they have left is each other, and through that they build, you know, their everything again.
And yeah. We do mean literally everything, because I do love the garden, but, like, this is really... You can see Will Vinton and his team's, like, sense of humor, like, fall in here because it's, you know, it's Adam and Eve running around, but they have all of these modern trappings, like, they have, like, sunglasses and beach chairs, and on the 7th day, God created beach umbrellas, and it's very charming.
They have, like, TV antennas when there's, like, no, there'd be no TV shows, and...
Can we talk about how Adam doesn't know what kids are for, like, a good portion of that fucking time? His wife gets real big and then thin and has a child, and he's like, where'd she get that thing? I think it's a bear. If Cain had stayed a bear, he'd have been better. Like, it's a fucking... He goes looking for a kid for 3 months, it comes back, and Abel is born. Like, it's fucking hilarious.
My favorite sort of, not even a blink and you miss it thing, because they do, obviously there's no blink and you miss it thing, because everyone spent so much time working on this, they want you to see
everything. No, they want you to see every frame. Yeah, they don't cut quick at any point in this movie, you're right.
I love how when Adam and Eve are a little bit older and they have their entire family around, Cain is now like
a biker.
Like a leather jacket motorcycle punk, and
he's like, whatever, Dad, I'm gonna go to, there has to be people like me out there. Rebel without a cause.
Cain doesn't come back as a character, that's last time we see him. Kind of all like something's happening, that's gonna be its own story probably.
That's the scene that made me think that that movie was made for my family when we were kids, because Adam and Eve look so much like my parents, like I was telling you in the
I'm gonna have to take your word on that, man.
Especially in the 80s, like that scene, Adam with the mustache and like the, like, you know, like me, like the high forehead, you know what I'm talking about right here, and like the redhead Ma with the fucking curls. And then, like, Cain shows up, but he reminds me of my stepbrother who's older, Travis. It's fucked. It's really fucked up.
So this is why that movie had such a hold on you.
Huge impact! We were also raised, like, super Catholic. Super Catholic. Like, so Catholic we didn't notice, right? Until, like, you're of the age of reason.
I'm sure you noticed.
You didn't notice until you were, like, a little older, and you're like, oh, shit.
I was, like, 16, and I was walking around. I looked in the mirror, and I'm like, oh, shit, I'm Catholic as hell. Fuck.
Shouldn't have tattooed that cross on my forehead.
I'm covered in rosaries. What the hell?
Beads make shirts.
Shut up.
I like how they imply that you know, before death was actually introduced to the Garden of Eden, they still had vultures and buzzards and all these like animals, like these scavengers that would eat carrion and shit. But it's like it refuses to eat anything, so it's, oh well, you know, we're just gonna assume that it eats dead people. We don't have the concept of death just yet, but we're gonna keep this vulture around anyway, and I just feel, poor fucking vulture.
Well, that's kind of the funniest part of the movies, because these filmmakers are poking fun at the fucking creation, right? Well, yeah, we got the creation, we invented, we have all, God made all these animals, and made them just hang out and wait, because they couldn't do the things they wanted to in the garden where death doesn't exist.
Far be it from me, I mean, we could be like the movie and spend far more time in the Garden of Eden than we actually have to. Far be it from me to poke holes in the story of Mark Twain. There were a few things about the whole Garden of Eden thing that didn't quite make sense. There's like a scene early on where like Adam is trying to catch fish and then Eve is throwing rocks at him to get him to stop catching fish. But then later on she like grabs four random fish out of the pond and watches as they slowly asphyxiate and die.
You're
which
right.
raises a couple of questions given that they're in the Garden of Eden, because I always assumed it was like the Garden of Eden rules on The Simpsons, where there's like a talking pig that's all like, it's ribs on the menu today, and you just pull it out, but the pig's like fine, it's all like, well, see you tomorrow.
Shit, you're right. I forgot that was while they were still in the garden. That still happens when they're in the garden building the houses with the fucking drywall in the back.
And then there's also like another moment where Adam loves going over the falls, going, yahoo, enjoying himself. When Eve shows up, she's like worried about his safety, and she puts all these safety
signs.
It's
because she kills fish
in
her
paradise. Yeah, but I mean, they're in paradise, right? So they shouldn't be worried about death or pain or anything, right?
You're right.
I don't know. That's maybe, you know, it's like, I don't know, plot hole. Oh, I found a plot hole in this movie from 1985.
I think it ties more into how she's, they represent feminism as, like, deterring men from wasting endeavors of fucking bullshit. Because one of the best quotes in the movie is her saying, he seems more interested in rest than anything else. And I laugh my ass off every time I hear it. Like, because it's the truest shit I think I've ever heard. He seems more interested in resting than anything else.
Well, she's spending like most of the time like learning about the world, and he spends most of his time goofing off. Which is great. The one thing that I kind of teared up a little bit was at the end when they're both in the twilight of their years. You know, they're both like writing in their personal journals about like how neither of them wants the other one to die first. But when they actually have a conversation, like Adam just can't find the words. He talks about the weather, but then he looks back in the book and finds like this old heart that Eve had made for him as part of like a peace offering between them. And he gives it to her, and for the first time, he gets to name something. He names it a Valentine, and that kind of says volumes about like how he really wants to feel about her. I kind of teared up a little at that.
Dude, it's beautiful.
Beautiful, and then, of course, the camera pans out, and he's sitting by himself, and that, lovely.
And it's that beautiful tree metaphor that you were talking about. You love the trees. It's the heart from the tree. It's got A plus E in the carved in the tree with a heart around it, which makes you remember how A and E used to be a channel you learn things from and like. It's a really beautiful shot.
I'll tell you this much. When I was like doing the barest amount of research before this, I've just put on like a History Channel 3-minute recap of Mark Twain's life, and it really covered like the broad strokes. And then I watched another one that
he might have been an alien.
Yeah. I mean, they teased like the next video coming up, and it was about like some fucking demolition crew at like a mine in Alaska. It's like, oh boy, how the History Channel has fallen.
Mark Twain was one of the forefathers of American satire, but was he actually a lizardman?
Just asking the questions.
He was made of clay. That's why they made this movie in his honor. That was actually the real Mark Twain.
It's the most realistic depiction of Mark Twain in cinema.
He's still alive. They just keep him in a jar. He's about 4 foot tall.
Speaking about fucking realistic depictions of Mark Twain, do we want to start getting into like the fucking creepy,
Please, by all means, let's talk about this scene. If you have a passing knowledge of this movie, you know the scene we're talking.
Like, what's it called? Like, welcome to the whole damned human
it's
race.
It's called the
I want to talk about that.
No, I want to talk about fucking Satan.
Right.
Okay, let's talk about Satan. Jameson mentioned this earlier, and it's fine when we talk over each other, we're just more like the movie. Because they're in this elevator and it has like this very cheerful,
announcer voice. That's how he sounds.
And every time they get to a new thing, it's all like, welcome to the adventures of Tom Sawyer. But then they get to one point, it says probably my favorite line in the movie. And it's just, I just want to isolate that and have that be my alarm when I wake up every morning.
It speaks with like such a delightful
you know, whimsical, like, Disney PA announcer.
Oh, shucks. Welcome to the damned human race.
This is a kid's movie. G rating. Existentialism doesn't prey on your children at all. It's fine.
But yeah, so they meet Satan on this on this trip, who is depicted as this legless, headless, hexadecimal, like, mask.
Totally hexadecimal. Yeah, excellent, very, bold. Yeah.
And yeah, it is one of, like, there have been countless depictions of Satan in cinema and in, like, children's movies. This one's got to be up there as one of the fucking creepiest. He leads the kids into this black void, this floating island in this complete black void.
I got some insight into this. There's actually, like, an interesting little trivia thing. Yeah, so they go into Satan's domain or whatnot, and yeah, it's just an island in, like, this floating black void. And you mentioned, Jameson, earlier, the scene near the end where they almost toss out the manuscript of The Mysterious Stranger, and he says, don't do that, that won't be published yet for a while. The Mysterious Stranger was actually a story that Mark Twain never finished. So the reason that Satan, the mysterious stranger, is standing in a blank void is because there's nothing. There's no story there, and there never will be a story because Mark Twain never finished.
That's brilliant. Mm. I've read it. I've got a copy of it up here on one of my ridiculous shelves.
So it was published.
It was, because, and it's very different from the version we see. The mysterious stranger that you read is more of like one of those monkey's paws tales, you know what I mean? Like, I wish this would happen, and then the thing happens,
but at a terrible consequence.
Oh no, the thing happens. Yeah.
This version is way fucking creepy. Like, it's so fucked, the whole thing. Like, it's so fucked.
He takes the kids to, like, this sandbox where he says, like, create humans for me or something like that. Make these little clay figures, and they look like that they're fucking this delightful little kingdom where they're all getting along until, like, they're introduced to, like, possessions or something or a ruling class. And then they start turning on each other and combating, and he's like, how annoying these squabbling humans are to me. I will give them pestilence and death and earthquakes and shit. And God, like, the looks on the three fucking kids are horrified as, like, the earth splits open and, like, all the clay figures that they created are swallowed up by the earth. God, I'm gonna have nightmares about this guy.
He can make more sometime. Yeah. We need them.
Yeah, and then the mask morphs into a skull, and just, like, it's very upsetting imagery. Like, there's a little clay mother weeping over the charred body of her little clay
son. Who gets struck by lightning, and things ordering people to their death.
Yeah.
People falling in chasms, and they have no choice but to die in them. Everything knows it's gonna die.
It's the cow that goes through the
cow! The source of the fucking whole conflict of why they were fighting over a cow! That's how it all starts, right? Those two guys?
I'm one of those guys where, like, if I see, like, people getting hurt in a movie, I'm like, okay, well, you know, they're just fucking actors. But when I see, like, an animal, like a dog or a cow, any kind of animal, like, in any danger, like, now I'm fucking emotionally invested.
It doesn't matter if it's, like, a little mound of emotionless clay. Yeah,
I can't believe my hamburger got hurt.
I gotta say, I mean, there's so much that's disturbing about this scene, but on a meta level, there's something super disturbing about clay figures making and playing with clay figures. I don't know. That's, like, a level that I don't need.
Truly.
It just makes me, it makes my brain hurt a little bit too much.
God is brother and not father in this case. It's fucking scary and strange. You're not wrong.
I'll tell you one thing. There are entire people, like, conversations I had less than a month ago that just go into my brain and just whoosh, exit out the end. The amount of important, pertinent information that I have forgotten in my lifetime is astounding. I'll tell you one thing I have never forgotten, Garrett. What is your favorite fruit? Oranges, apples, grapes! That I will never forget. I've never forgotten that the first time I saw it, and I remembered it this time. I'll tell you one other thing.
Why? Those grapes, do you remember that?
Those grapes still look as delicious today as they did back then. Those are some good-looking grapes.
Well, I told you why I always remember it, but, like, I'll...
You did, but I was watching the movie, and I couldn't see the message, so explain on the podcast.
I texted, so you guys read it on the podcast. All right, so the kids are there, right? And it's Tom Sawyer and Huck Finn and Becky Thatcher. And Satan goes, what kind of fruit do you like the most? And Tom asks for oranges, and Becky asks for apples, and Huck asks for grapes. And the reason it's so telling about their characters is because you got Huck, whose father is a super alcoholic who beats him and shit, and that's why he runs away with Jim on the boat in the first place. Pretends he's dead and gets away from his dad who's been beating him, who's a total drunk. So of course he loves grapes, because his old man loves the grapes. Then you got Becky Thatcher, who's the complete representation of women throughout the film besides Eve, right? There's nothing comparable to the endurance of a woman. Like, that's Becky Thatcher. And so she likes the apple because the apple's been thrust in our face throughout the story. And then you got Tom, who is a total narcissist, who just loves anything orange because his hair is orange. Orange!
That one's a bit of a stretch. You were great for two-thirds of that theory.
I had you, right? I had you for two-thirds of the argument. He is, though. He's a piece of shit. Tom loves himself so... Aaron, I've been trying everything I know. Not even a little bit famous yet. Like, he just fucking loves himself so much. Oranges. It's the same color as me. I want orange.
Yeah, I always, like I never read Tom Sawyer. I always had the understanding that he was, like, a bit of a rascal. Like
he's the worst!
He would con other kids to, like, doing his chores for him and shit like that. So he was too smart for his own good, but a bit of a rapscallion. Like, didn't he fake his death and attend his own funeral and
stuff? Yeah, that happens in the first book. In the second book, he doesn't even tell Jim he's been free for days because he thinks it's funny.
Oh, what an asshole.
He's a piece of shit!
I will say, though, he was right on the money when he said, like, when he kind of clued in that, like, hey, I think Mark Twain is trying to kill himself and he's got a death wish. We gotta get off this fucking airship. Because they run into Mark Twain after they meet Satan, and he's like fucking, he's emo Mark Twain now. He is a huge fucking downer. He plays his really sad pipe organ.
With all those living people in the organ.
Okay, can I just...
The sentient organ.
Since we've mentioned the pipe organ here, everyone remembers the Satan part of this movie. It's the thing that everyone on the internet talks about. It shows up on the list like, this is wild. I feel like not enough people talk about this utterly nightmarish pipe organ that he plays. I think everyone is just kind of desensitized by everything that just happened in the Stranger thing.
Because it's true.
Just, if you just watched that scene out of context, you'd go, Jesus Christ,
dude,
that's
it's
fucking
it's
horrifying.
Actually my favorite part of the whole movie. For many reasons. Let me explain why. I mean, it is fucked up and crazy. They take that wonderful fucking song, that fucking banjo with the Billy scream. Pick-a, pick-a, pick-a. The flesh, coming to find you. Like, so 80s. And they turn it into this slow ass, exactly, you don't know what I'm talking about, but listen to the main theme of the movie.
The credits song.
By Billy Scream. I think I said Billy Ocean like an idiot.
I'm gonna say it's fucking rad as hell. It's like a
bluegrass. It's so rad. Yeah, Billy Scream. Fucking the heroes or whatever. We can be heroes.
Yeah,
and they turn it into this really sad, horrible organ music. The reason I love that scene so much is because the art in it is incredible. When the organ is playing and then the choir comes in, right? And they must have shot it in reverse or something because, like, they're super detailed and they go into mold. They're super moldy and then come into detail. They're just, it's beautiful. It's un-fucking-believably beautiful. And it's, like, maybe 30 seconds of the whole picture. And Mark Twain is so sad and lamenting, like, his fate. It's just, it's gorgeous. But, yes, it sticks with you so hard because what is this sentient horrible? And the best part about that whole organ scene is it's a player piano. He's pulling the shit and watching the drippity drops. He's not playing it.
Watching the drippity drops. Yeah, this blimp has a lot of drippity drops. Like do you notice when it's like flying around, there's kind of like the engine in the back and there's just like that. It's like a slinky of clay that's just like going in and out of like these pipes. It's pooping out clay like all over the place. Yeah.
That's the thing that I thought was the worms. The worms that are in the back of the engine.
Yeah, they power the fucking thing somehow. These dicks and assholes power the backside of the ship.
That pipe organ scene to me is, it sticks to me because throughout the most part of the movie, Mark Twain was like this witty, charming, whimsical kind of guy who was teaching kids about his ambitions to go see the comet and to like, you know, teach them about his writing. And then in this moment, he is so melancholy and he's like completely switched gears to like this tragic figure. And I again kind of felt, oh, I wasn't anticipating this for this character. Like, I understand Mark Twain as a humorist, but, and like, I know there's a humor award written for him, but I never really clued into how much of his humor is dark and largely cynical. You know, like, that'll play into the end there. But yeah, I wasn't anticipating that.
All of his work is super cynical. Like, if you read his work, it's very cynical. There's this wonderful one about, I can't remember the title of it. And the whole thing is basically, like, story titles from newspapers, right? And it's just, like, missing elephant. Then it's, like, elephant's gone this way. And then, like, the army's been dispatched to get the elephant. Elephant claimed it's been shot 36 times and it's dead, but they got the elephant back. Like, that's the kind of humor that his writing is like. I mean, I'm nutshelling it.
You have 10 minutes to move your car. You have 5 minutes to move your car. Yes. Into a cube, you have 10 minutes to move your cube. Yes.
Totally. Yeah. And he even says his best quote in the movie for describing his work is his work is water. My work is water. Those of the great whatever something or other is wine, but everybody drinks water. And that's why his work was so popular, because his work, anybody could read it and pick up on it and understand and identify with it so well. I insist, if you guys get the chance, read some of his shit. Even The Mysterious Stranger is a wonderful little... It's not a very long story. It's great.
Yeah. That's the caveat with Mark Twain, is that, like, oh, I've never read Mark Twain. Well, he wrote a lot of short stories, so we probably will be able to read, like, a couple of them.
Oh, exactly.
And they're public domain. Yes. There we go. So you have... There's a call to action. Everyone listening to this, you have literally no reason not to read any Mark Twain.
Or you have literally a reason, and it's the 80s, and you don't know how to read because of all those 80s tropes.
Our recommendation for this episode is to read a bunch of Mark Twain.
Hashtag Mark Twain website.
I think the moment that really surprised me with how dour and glum Mark Twain was, like you say, it's like really emo Mark Twain. I think the scene that really kind of took me by surprise was when he climbed up on the chair and he carved in Twain was here into the rafter up top.
I mean, he might as well have. This poor actor has to play a suicidal character in all these movies we know him by.
Well, two.
Those are the two. Name another movie you know him by. Name another one. Yeah. I double dog dare you. You don't. You're a lying sack of shit if you do.
I can't think of anything right now. Thank you very much. Hey, before we move off of this mysterious stranger scene entirely, did you notice the cameo in this scene?
Which one?
Those grapes that Huck Finn was holding? Very early cameo from the California Raisins.
Oh, damn. Oh, fuck.
Good night, everybody. All right.
Hey, you fucking... No, right. If I had a snare and fucking cymbal, I would go for it just for your sake.
It's a podcast. I can edit it in.
Oh, thank you, brother. Just do it. Just do it right now. Hang on. Everyone pause. Okay, we had it. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Shit. No, let's not... Like, wait, let's not go away from the scene yet. Wait, let's not go away from...
Okay, no, what more do you have to say?
This is fucking crazy. He can't even hexadecimal. It doesn't even describe the scary, weird... Now, they fuck up a lot of times because they're like, oh, Satan. That's a sorry name for an angel, but the angel's name is Lucifer. There's just so many horrible things to talk about. It's about how, like, classism exists, even in, like, the fucking first 5 seconds of someone being sentient. We're gonna just have kings and queens. And then this terrible fucking ending for all. We can make more again sometime. If we need them. Life is... Oh, shit. How does the quote go? Do you guys remember? And you... And you are but a thought. And the fucking fade out, and it ends up in the iris of Mark Twain. It's just such a beautiful scene. Okay, we can move on now. I'm sorry, I kept us there. It's just so crazy.
It's definitely not an optimistic depiction of the human race. We're born flawed, we die, there'll be more of us, and, you know, we're all just destined to be awful shits to each other. This really is, like, the work of fucking emo Mark Twain. Which, like, I know, like, he had, like he had a couple of children die, and...
And his wife died before him.
Yeah, I mean, I can understand why he would be a bummer, you know? I don't understand why he's, like, you know, celebrated as a humorist when, like, he would, at most, do a lot of dramedy.
Well, he says it himself in the movie. I mean, we're lucky because we have that, like, weird portrayal of him as a good person, and then the dark side of him floating around the ship the whole movie, and we don't really understand until the end. As a child, it really threw me. I didn't understand what the fuck was going on. Hang on, I'm like,
but then
this evil twin?
Then it's hammered onto a way that you as a kid can understand, because at the end the two sides merge and you get like the awesome two-faced suit, and that's like, that kind of explains it all.
Yeah, because he has that quote, every man has a mood and has a dark side, which he never reveals to anybody.
If he can help it.
Yeah.
I want to keep this moving along because there's a couple of other weird and wacky moments. There's so many that we got to talk about. I do want to describe to the people listening at home that whenever Garrett does his Mark Twain impression, he's holding an invisible cigar in his hand. I don't know if you've noticed it, but you've done it literally every time.
Oh, that's fucking horrible.
For posterity, I just want to say
that's
that.
How you get in character.
I hope it's a cigar.
That's true. I go right to Groucho Marx when I think of Mark Twain.
So the kids sabotage the airship, so, like, you know, he can't make it to the Halley's Comet. But then they find out that the reason he does have a death wish and to, like, make it to Halley's Comet is because he does miss his wife, and he never had the intention of killing or having the children die along with them. He would have given them control of the ship to sail on home.
Yes, because that's the metaphor of the story, is that the kids aren't real. They don't necessarily understand that they're not real, that they're fiction. But the whole idea is that Mark Twain is going on. He's going to catch the comet, and then they will continue to live and exist forever. They are essentially immortal beings and will continue to be that way as long as people remember the stories of Mark Twain.
And I just say, like, at the moment where Mark Twain realizes the ship has been sabotaged and, like, the fucking Star Trek warning siren goes off, that kind of took me out of the movie a little bit.
It does.
What the fuck is this sci-fi shit going on right now? But I gotta say, it kind of redeemed itself because now it became exciting. And the ticking clock element became...
And it really ties that frog subplot together, man. This whole fucking movie, Huck Finn's got a frog for no reason. He's not in the books. This weird fucking frog is not a fucking frog.
I was gonna ask about that, if Huck Finn had a thing with Homer.
I mean, it's been a bit since I read one. I don't think I've seen fucking Homer.
Yeah, they're fucking locked in the parlor room there. They're like, all the doors have been locked during the security breach or whatever fucking problem that they're having. And so, well, portholes are too small for anyone to fit through, except for the frog. So we gotta hope that, you know, however high they are in the fucking air, that they can just hold this frog out a window and it'll jump however high he needs to jump in
but
the air.
But we see, like, all the breadcrumbs,
and
right?
It almost fucking works.
Almost, you're
this
right.
Is such an
almost.
Interesting. This is such an interesting movie to discuss and kind of pull apart, because there are so many layers that you can go with. Once you accept the fact that this is like a metaphorical blimp journey that Mark Twain is going on, and he's just imagined it in his head, the fact that his creations are worried about disappearing and have sabotaged his ship, and now they are all ostensibly trapped in this room and he cannot get out. It's all like, we're all locked into this room. It's all like, you, Mark Twain, you're making this shit up as you go. You don't have to be locked into the thing. It's not just that, because the frog jumps up and he lands on the button, but it's not just that the frog gets the mouse.
No, this is the crux of the whole plot.
He doesn't land on the button.
He misses.
Emo Mark Twain comes and he kind of like nudges the
frog. He ashes his ash of his cigar over the frog, so the frog will back up and hit the button. Cause the emo fucking in Twang would hit the button himself.
Cause he could have derailed the entire trip right there and like woken up and like still lived and whatnot. But there was a part of him. There was a part of this
that wanted him to fuck it up.
That's like, nah, you know what? Maybe we do need to see this through to the end.
We need a climax right here.
Yeah, like that. I think that's against character, because he is this nihilistic Mark Twain that like is so bitter with the way the world has gone. He doesn't even think that there is going to be an afterlife. So why the fuck are we going after Halley's Comet anyways? But yeah, I'll just we'll see where this goes.
Again, more metaphors. Oh, here we go. Yes,
speaking of afterlife, let's
speak
of it. We're running a little long, but we gotta talk about
it. I thought it was a podcast. Aren't these usually like 6 hours long? I got my fucking barbecue and my Coleman set up and a fucking
Are you grilling?
I'm grilling in my
grill.
I love it. You look indoors, man. I'm surprised smoke isn't filling the room.
I don't want to talk about it.
Yeah, we'll talk about anything else regarding this movie, but my private life, you know, no dice.
So this is a Mark Twain story where, I guess, like an old man on his way to his version of heaven, but he takes a wrong turn in Albuquerque and ends up in this alien heaven where these purple aliens...
Oh, wait, you're talking about Captain Stormfield.
Stormfield.
Captain Stormfield.
Yeah.
Didn't realize that was his name. That is an amazing name.
That's,
I love that.
That's right. Not Captain Howdy for all you possessed types out there. It's
so he goes to see like fucking Saint Three-Headed Peter or whatever, and he says, they ask him, so where are you from? He's like, I'm from San Francisco. No planet with that name. Where, can you be a little bit more specific?
And he says, the world! The world!
Well, before he says the world, he goes like, I get it. America.
Oh, right.
United States of America. I mean, like, you know. It's old. This type of archetype is older than 1985. It's, you know, from Mark Twain's era, but it's amazing how that archetype of, like, no one is more important than the patriotic United States of America.
Well, the media tells me that, so obviously.
Yeah. Even when he is literally staring into oblivion and conversing with a being that his mind has no tangible way of understanding, he's still, I need a halo, I need a harp, this is all wrong, I want to talk to, he's the first Karen.
Oh my god, you're right.
Talk to your alien.
That's why it's Captain Stormfield. They don't want to give you his first initial is K.
Yeah.
Well, Karen Stormfield? Are you fucking kidding me?
My god.
It's perfect.
That would be.
And then, fucking Karen Storm t-shirt.
Right, Karen Stormfield!
Yeah, he's just like this entitled American guy who says, like, hey, you must know me, I'm Captain Karen Stormfield from San Francisco, California, in the United States of America. Let me into heaven.
He's literally outside the club, too, trying to get into the club, by the way.
Which
at this
it is
point.
A club.
It is. Heaven's a club, for these three-headed... Well, Quirk, where are you from? These fucking three heads.
Of heaven that, like, advertises 24-hour pizza and beer.
Oh, dude, the shit they say in there? Like, you know, I don't know if you guys heard a lot of the shit that was going on in the background. You can hear one of them go... No, you didn't, but it's in there. Can we do any more what rated G movie?
Everything. All of it. Can we do all of it?
And it frightens Karen fucking Stormfield. So he goes to white man heaven, which sucks.
I mean, the depiction of, like, what that fucking space heaven or that alien heaven looked like to him, I gotta think, like, that's what a lot of... You know, not to get fucking political on here, but I'm sure that's how a lot of people in red states view life in blue states. It's just a club full of weirdos that, like, oh, what is this? Oh, no, I want to go to the white man's heaven.
A harp, a hymn book, and wings? By God, what a swindle.
And, like, four other things that, like, I'm not religious, but, like, four other things that I had never heard of before. Like, he was, like, and, like, a bay leaf? Or, like, something, it's just all, like, I don't know, it's, like, whatever. Yeah, it's, like, I mean, we're talking about t-shirts. They go into, like, the alien heaven. One of the aliens is wearing a t-shirt that says, Let's Grok.
Like,
sign me up right now. I'm gonna see if that shirt exists, and then if it doesn't, I'm ordering one.
Oh,
let's Grok indeed.
I wanna Grok? Are you fucking kidding me right now?
Yeah, so anyways, like, you know, Stormfield, like, does eventually go to white people's heaven, where, you know, he gets his wings, and says, here's your hymn book, now go do the exact same.
And he has to be quiet. Shh, quiet.
He's gotta be quiet, yeah. Which has always been sort of, like, again, I'm not, you know, religious myself, but that's always been sort of my impression of, you know, if you gotta do everything, like, by these, like, strict rules for your entire, like, human life just to get into, like, paradise, but it's gonna be mostly the exact same, why the fuck would you want to go to something like that? That's why I think going to hell would be awesome, because you're with, like, you know, a bunch of people like to party. And the devil's going to take care of his own. Maybe not
quotes.
The devil from this movie, but...
Yeah, you get kicked out of heaven, and then you end, and, like, you get down to, like, hell, and he shows it, like, Jameson, what fruits do you like? And you're like, I've made a horrible mistake. It's all bad. Both choices are bad.
Yeah.
That's why Mark Twain had the right idea. Chase a comet and then become like this ethereal mist at the end.
That's all you
have. That's for me. Sign me up.
That's real life and how it was.
Choice number one, grokking with the aliens. Choice number two, comet mist.
I mean, fucking tell that to the fucking Heaven's Gate people.
Well, he says it twice, right? Because like in that, the whole part of that story is a man has to be in his own heaven to be happy. That's the whole moral, and he even says those lines. That's like the whole moral of that fucking hilarious, ridiculous story.
Hilarious. Now, Garrett, as our resident Twain historian, given that at the time when Mark Twain was writing these stories, perhaps suggesting that the word of the good book might have a couple holes in it, a couple logical things, did he receive any sort of pushback for these views?
Nope. Everyone loved him and thought he was fine.
Everyone was fine with it?
Yeah,
okay, that's
just
that
really
tracks.
Cool
yep.
with it. And we're like, you know what? This guy, we're Americans and we're very mature and think this man is entitled to his opinion and think that this guy's got a couple of points, realistically. That's how it all went down.
They treat him like fucking like an observational comedian.
Yeah, they were like, oh, he's fine. He's like George Carlin and Dave Chappelle. Haha, he's fine.
Yeah, and it carried over into today where if we know anything for as an absolute fact, it's that always listen to the words of an old white man in a white suit.
They're the white suit especially.
That person never has any problematic attitudes about anything.
Dude, they can make chicken like nobody's business. Yeah. Listen to those guys. They're the ones you want, especially if they have one of those ties that's not a tie.
I would eat at Mark Twain's fried chicken.
Oh, my God. Mark Twain's fried chicken would be fucking literally delicious.
I'll get the Cluck Finn meal. Thank you very much.
Oh, no. Oh, the Becky Thatcher?
The puns are going to keep coming, so let's wrap up here.
Yeah, sorry. I'm sorry.
So the kids fire up the thrusters on the airship, which apparently were always there, even though they were on a time crunch to meet the comet.
They could have got there in 10 minutes, but we needed a movie to fill.
The journey is the destination.
We got to go by sky fucking paddle wheel riverboat until like we actually, you know, have to catch in the last second, which I was kind of impressed by. That's kind of a cool looking sequence.
Oh, it was such a good scene with the fucking sword fight armor shit.
Like, this fucking ship could do anything. It has, like, these retractable arms on it that can heal the ship and, like, catch frogs that fall overboard.
My favorite part, retractable arms with the big white cartoon glove.
Love,
that's
man.
How you know it's a retractable arm when it's got a big Mickey Mouse glove on the end of it. That's how you know it works.
I like how to navigate it, like, it operates exactly like how riverboats do, where, like, there has to be people on either side, like, calculating, I don't know, like, either the depth or...
Depth and distance, yeah.
And the distance, yeah. Which is actually how, like, Mark Twain got his pen name from.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
From working those riverboats.
Oh, I didn't know that! Well, I was actually going to ask... No,
really?
No, because legitimately!
They say it, like, 20 times with echoes in the movie!
I know! I was going to... That's going to be my question. What was the deal with them firing ropes and saying Mark Twain over again? You know what? Like, this has been an entire podcast's worth of me proving what an uneducated slob I am. I legitimately did not know until right now his name was not Mark Twain.
No, it's Samuel
That's
Clemens.
That's news to me.
It was a pen name, yeah. He picked it up when he was like a fucking, like a riverboat captain.
He was actually a Mississippi riverboat pilot, like he says
in the
picture.
You know what? Now that you said Samuel Clemens, I'm all like, you know what? Maybe I did actually know that.
You did
but
know.
Like, yeah. I'd forgotten.
Exactly.
But, there we go. Hey. I learned something.
That kind of fucking trivia is just like classics in the movie. Something everybody wants to have read, but nobody wants to read. So that same kind of shit.
Well, watching this movie is just as good as reading his ovir.
His ovir. That's the fucking...
His ovir?
We gotta...
We just get farther... Every time we say that, we just get farther and farther away from the way it's pronounced.
Over. Anyway... So they all catch up to Haley's comet. Emo Mark Twain steps out of the shadows. He says, like, oh no, he's a part of me and he's gotta go with me to the afterlife. You kids will live on forever. The two Mark Twains merge into the Two-Face version, and then he
Yes, thank you, Jameson. I wrote down the same thing.
It's so true.
It's like, oh, he's making a Two-Face and oh wait, they have the same face.
They have the same face.
They have the same face.
And then the kids pilot the ship home and the fucking movie ends to that fucking awesome bluegrass rock opera.
Billy Scream, man!
I listened to that, like, when it first came out, I was like, what the hell is this? And then, like, the more I kind of just let it run around my head, I'm like, what the hell is this? I let it play out. Like, I watched the whole credits just to listen to that.
Then I clearly did not listen to it enough. All right, are there any individual moments? I mean, there's so many.
So many.
We could talk for another hour just about, like, the little things that happen in this movie that we love. But are there any individual stuff that we didn't mention that we want to bring up here really quick before we wrap up?
Yeah, there's a one scene where the kids stumble upon the room that's just called Mark Twain's Notebook. And they see, like, a depiction of Mark Twain just kind of rambling to himself. And so they figure, okay, well, we gotta sabotage the ship. If he's here, let's just tie him to the chair and we won't be disturbed as we sabotage the ship. When they get back to the deck, they see that, you know, Mark Twain, you know, that wasn't the real Mark Twain. So, like, there's two Mark Twains. And he describes that rambling Mark Twain in that other room as, that's just a little bit of writer's block. Which, I gotta say, as a guy who's, like, written his own shit, like, whenever I hit a wall, like, fuck, I would love to use that as an excuse.
It's one of the best fucking scenes in the movie. You're not wrong. It's got my favorite quote.
He's just in his Stephen King memory palace. Files everywhere.
It's my palace.
Well, he's rambling about horrible shit in this kids movie. This is rated G movie. When I get over on the other side, I'm going to use my influence to have the human race drowned again. This time, no omission. No arc. Then he passes out and they tie him up. What kind of drunken uncle fucking scene is this?
Hey, man, who hasn't had a night like that, right?
It's so so true. This is Rona Truth, fucking 2001, right? 2001? I said 2001, right? That was a mistake.
2020. We're at 2021.
2021,
now.
Huh? I gotta keep up. I'm just.
You don't even know what fucking year it is.
I was, 2001, also a bad year. Maybe we skip that so year far, too. Yeah. Not a great one.
You're right. The other thing I'll mention is that the snake in the Garden of Eden sequence had really fucked up eyes. They couldn't, and human teeth.
And fucked up human teeth thing. I feel like that's the more prevalent of the two terrifying things about that snake.
Was smoking a match for no fucking reason.
No, he just kept it in his mouth, you know? Yeah. For that cigarette he couldn't wait to have.
There's an adult education course nearby.
He's hilarious.
That's all I really gotta say.
I really love, I mean, there's so many just, like, amazing visuals in this. Like, I'd say maybe, like, 98%. Maybe a little less of this movie is claymation, but every once in a while, they do, like, these really amazing sort of watercolor-based, like, blending effects.
Yeah,
like,
totally.
When Eve is looking at her reflection in the water.
Right.
That's stunning. I don't know how they pulled that off.
No,
that
and there's,
gorgeous.
Like, the other shot where the ship is really far away in the night sky. It's, like, though, like, following a hall at home in the dark. And it's that beautiful fucking, the clouds? Do you know what I mean?
The swirling clouds look amazing.
Yeah,
all the stuff with the comet looks incredible. I just wrote down one visual gag that I really like that I want to mention here. Adam goes off on this quest after Cain is born because he wants to find where Cain came from. And he, like, loads a bunch of, like, unnecessary stuff in a wagon that he's clearly built himself because it has these big square wheels.
Square wheels instead of wheels.
So as he's pulling his square-wheeled cart away, a fucking
soccer ball
falls off of the head. It's just great.
And then his little kid makes the wheel.
This is the point entirely.
Cain makes fucking actual wheel.
Why would that be there?
Soccer ball. He's got a soccer ball.
This was during prehistory, but still everybody had fucking toasters and TV antennas and crossword puzzles.
They all wore tank tops.
And drywall and white picket fences.
All right, Garrett, is there, because you clearly know this movie so well, is there any, like, one moment we haven't mentioned here, or did we cover everything?
I think we covered practically everything. You guys were, like, looking for a good quote for, like, the end, I think. I would say, heaven for climate, hell for company is the quote I would go with for this picture.
Quote about cabbages and cauliflowers?
Totally, that's us! Cabbages! Especially you guys, cabbages to cauliflower, because you guys
started this podcast as cabbages, and now we are.
I had it written down, and I was so excited I couldn't read it. It was so scribbly. Cabbages to cauliflower!
Like, isn't it like cauliflower is cabbage with a
college education.
Like college
education. That's, he was a smart guy.
Fucking
smart guy.
Brilliant.
Garrett, for the first time, I think I'm going to omit asking you this question. The answer is pretty obvious. Jameson, would you recommend The Adventures of Mark Twain?
Yeah, I think I would, actually. I think this is a very visually interesting movie. I think it runs the gamut of being... It can be really funny one moment. It can be really scary and existential the next one. I thought the scene with, like, them trying to steer the ship towards the comet was, like, very exciting. This movie kind of checks a lot of boxes for me. It's weird enough. It kind of runs the full gamut of the emotional spectrum. I don't know if I kind of gained a new perspective on Mark Twain out of this. But I think, you know, for such a weird fucking premise of a movie that I never would have expected to kind of come together and work... It kind of comes together in this weird harmony. So I'd say, yeah, give it a shot.
Awesome. Yeah, no, I completely agree with you. I think this is a really good movie. I will add the caveat that I think if this script, even though the more we talk about it, the more layers we realize that it does in fact have. But I will say that this script on its own, the way it's written, if it was presented in a medium different from this one, if it was a traditionally animated movie or a live action movie, I don't think it would work as well as it does.
Yeah,
I think the claymation adds so much to this because there are parts of it where the plot can get maybe a little meandering, but on the flip side of that, I appreciate how there's so many scenes that are just there simply for mood. In this, like, there's a scene where the three kids are just kind of, like, laying in their bunk beds and they're kind of staring out the window and looking into space, and there's no dialogue for, like, a minute. And it's like, that scene didn't need to be there, but I appreciated that it was there because it was just kind of, like, a nice, quiet moment where we kind of, like, sit with the characters. I feel like the best Miyazaki movies have those moments of calm as well, too, where nothing's really going on. You're just looking at stuff.
It's got really good character, this movie, like, even when, like, nothing truly is happening. I think I mentioned in our chat that I was getting really tired of the antics of Adam and Eve because I didn't know what the... like, it was just
all those Adam and Eve and their wacky antics.
It just went on and on and on. And then the payoff happened at the end. And, like, that kind of, like, centered it all for me. So I was like, oh, that was actually really kind of sweet and beautiful. Like, I followed them on this journey. And I kind of grew to love them.
It's true.
Totally. And look, I was throwing some shade earlier at the animation style of Will Vinton and how it's kind of nightmare-inducing, but this guy was a genius. He was an artiste. Mm-hmm. Like, no one made animation look the way he did. He has a singular style. Other people make shit out of clay. Like, you know, you can think of stuff like Gumby or Pingu or whatever the hell and stuff like that. It doesn't look like this. There's an edge to this. There's kind of like an uncomfortableness to it that really makes Vinton's work stand out among the pack.
Yeah,
so,
like Van Gogh,
and I feel
man.
Like this is a great primer for it. And as an added plus, he's not trying to sell you anything. You don't have to buy raisins or terrible pizza. You can just enjoy
just
it.
Just buy a little Christianity. Just buy a little of it.
Buy a little bit into it, and you'll go to a nice white heaven. Garrett Quirk, thank you so much for being our first guest in this third go-around of
Thank you.
The Fuck Is This? You were the perfect...
So
you were the perfect guest for this.
I'm glad it worked out. Fuck, I'd love to do it again, man. This was a lot of fucking fun.
Dude, happy to
have
you.
Yeah, man, anytime. It was a blast to have you. Do you want to take a second to plug yourself? Anything you want to tell the folks about yourself?
Oh, no, you already said it at the beginning, man. Check out that Surly Bartender, man. It's great. I'm a lot not as nicer on that show. And swear a considerable amount more. So check that out. Surly Bartender. Just look it up. You'll see a redhead's face like Mark Twain once looked, but not in this picture. Check out the movie, Mark Twain, The Adventures of Mark Twain, 1985. You should fucking do it. They could really use your support. They're going to fall apart without you. Like and subscribe.
Dug this up from the grave.
Those cocksuckers really need your help, so.
Mark Twain was just on the cusp of being forgotten.
So brought him bring back. It back.
This podcast is sending it over the edge. Yeah. just to fill the audience in a little bit more, yeah, Garrett creates these great 3 to 5 minute YouTube videos where he takes on the persona of the Surly Bartender, and they're just instructional little videos on how to make various cocktails, and he does it with an attitude. And they're very funny, and they're very well edited. They're very well edited.
They are very well edited.
The editing is hilarious in those.
That's very nice to say.
You lock down that style and that look pretty quickly, and I appreciate that as a fellow content creator.
Well, thanks very much, guys. Thank you very much. And a fucking best of luck to you in the rest of your third season. Third season?
Thanks, buddy. Yeah, whatever, we'll call them.
Fuck it, I'm calling it a season, fuck it. Your third fucking season.
A season implies that we took a break in between doing them. We're kind of just...
Our breaks are like the weeks between episodes.
But when you release your DVDs, because people still buy those, and people want DVDs and soundtracks.
When live shows start opening up again, we'll have to take a break when Kaz and I take this show on the road.
That's right.
Eventually,
people's
who knows?
Garages
I mean,
and shit.
We're almost at 50 episodes, and I can't quite believe we got there.
That's
so.
Wild. That's
they
great.
Said we wouldn't make it past one.
Who said that?
No
we
one.
Did. That's true. Jameson, what are you watching? What are you listening to? What do you recommend this week?
So two recommendations I have. Over the holidays, I watched the movie Buffaloed, which is it's a cute little indie comedy starring Zoe Dutch. And Jai Courtney, who is actually pretty good in it.
Oh, great.
Yeah, it's just about like a young scam artist. It's pretty good. And a game that I want to plug here that I found out through a friend of the show, Scott. It's called Wrestling Empire. And what it is, it's a game for the Switch, but everything is made to look and control like an old N64 wrestling game. And nailed it. They nailed the look and the gameplay of it. A better playing and controlling and looking game than, well, not looking, but... It certainly performs better than Cyberpunk 2077, I'll tell you that much.
Very cool, very cool. Yeah, that's interesting. I hadn't thought about that a lot because retro gaming is a thing, but I guess there might be, we might start seeing like a small resurgence of retro from like the N64 PS1 era. That would be cool. I'd love to see more of that.
Still play my SNES. Hell, I've been playing Earthworm Jim lately. Forget about
it. Love that fucking game.
That right? Nice. Exactly. Not as bad as some of them, those games where you can't. Dude, I've got games from the NES I've never beaten the second level of. Hell, you know that game from the SNES, Zombies Ate My Neighbors? Same guys
who made
Earthworm Jim.
Great game.
You never beat that game. You never beat it.
There's like 150 levels.
It's absurd!
I don't think anyone has beaten that level yet.
I thought I beat the game or was close to it, and I looked it up and like, I hadn't beaten 25%.
A couple years ago, I got myself one of those SNES classic minis.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, I've been playing that thing for 2 years, man. I haven't gone past the first level on most of those games, man. SNES was hard.
Hard?
That shit's hard, man. My fucking lazy ass brain can't fucking attune to it anymore. I need, cause I've just been weaned onto like cell phone games that deliver instant gratification.
Right.
You don't have to try all that hard. So quickly, I want to recommend a movie I saw the other day that was really great. Made me nostalgic for a time that I thought I had truly left behind me. It's a great movie called Bloody Nose, Empty Pockets, and it's a mockumentary, but not in an obnoxious way. Basically, they just got a bunch of non-professional actors, and it's the story about the last day of this shitty dive bar in Las Vegas. It's the last night. It's going to close down at the end of the night, and it's just a cameraman in this bar, and it's just a very slacker-esque rumination on these people and their lives. Made me really wistful for my scumbum origins, you know, of like handing out, and in particular, you know, like this deep into the pandemic and everything, at the end of it, I'm just like, man, I would love to just go to, like, a dive bar. Like, I would love to go to, like, a shitty hotel dive bar filled with, like, the most depressing people in the world. I don't know what it is about nostalgia. Sometimes it makes you nostalgic for bad things.
That's because nostalgia, like, literally means, like, pain from an old wound.
Oh, wow. I learned so much. Yeah. I learned so much this episode. Great. But yeah, I recommend that. And thank you. That was The Adventures of Mark Twain from 1985, directed by Will Vinton. If you like the show, please follow us on Instagram at The F Is This Podcast. Like us on Facebook. We have a new Facebook page that you can like and become a member of, and we'll start interacting with you on there. And follow us on Twitter at @TheF_IsThis. And now, with our movie-specific catchphrase, because we've retired my earlier catchphrase that Jameson couldn't stand. Our new Mark Twain-inspired catchphrase for this episode is... That's you. I'm pointing to you, Jameson. You have the reins now. You had an entire year where all you did was shit on my catchphrase. You know what? This year, it's on you, buddy. You said this in the last one, and I'm following through. You get to come up with a catchphrase at the end of every episode. So now, with our episode-specific catchphrase, Jameson Rafter.
Garrett, what did you have again? What did you suggest? Actually, I did have one coming up here, and I thought it was like very wistful. I looked up what the final words of Mark Twain were, and they were, "If we meet."
All right.
Yeah.
Well, there we go. If we meet.
Cabbages to cauliflower.
That fucking sucks.
Right. And, you know, to take us out, let's grok.
Oh, my. That's fucking
much better,
wonderful.
Yeah.
I can see
grok
it.
Out with our smock out. I was going to say cock.
I know, but
that's obvious.
You know, silly.
How many penises do you think those aliens have?
All of
they had,
them.
Like, three heads.
They had that back penis that we could see shooting in and out over and over again.
That's the thing that Stormfield was most uncomfortable about. Everybody did have, like, their giant back penises out. Just flicks it at
you. You mean tails?
No, they were more back penises.
Tails.
I think they were back
what
penises.
What is a tail if not a back penis, though? I know, we really ripped the lid off of this. This
all
is
right,
what
well, bye,
we
everybody.
Like
thanks for listening.
Goodbye, everybody. Yes, that's what we do. Even though for some reason it doesn't quite always sync up, I haven't quite figured it out, but having the clap is better than not having the clap. That's what my dad always used to tell me. Boy, am I glad that that's going to make it into the episode. All right.